Welcome back to Movie Recap. Today I'm gonna show you a 2012 Russian war film called White Tiger. Spoilers ahead. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the video. The movie begins in 1943 at the Eastern Front tank battle during summer. As World War II ends, the soldiers walk towards the wrecked vehicles to check if there are still enemies inside the tanks. While scanning, the comrade captain knocks the gear to call his soldier, asking if he already takes out the man inside. Unfortunately, the soldier says his hands are stuck, so the comrade captain looks inside. To his surprise, he finds an alive tank crew driver in a disabled Soviet tank, almost running out of breath because of the burns in his body. Afterward, the soldiers carry him to move his body out of the disabled tank. Then, they take him to the hospital using the military vehicle. Seconds later, they finally arrive where the doctors and nurses are curing wounded soldiers. At first, the doctor refuses to see the burned man, but when the nurse checks his pulse, still beating, the doctor orders the soldiers to bring him to the tent. Miraculously, the tank crew driver recovers from burns covering 90% of his body with no scarring. Later at night, the doctor visits the recovered tank crew driver in the isolation room. Then, he orders the nurse to change his dressings. Afterward, the doctor asks his name, but the tank crew member answers that he doesn't know his name. So, they start digging some of his information, and request to call the tank crew member to interrogate him. Luckily, they find out that his name is Nadiwanov Ivan Ivanovich, a Russian born in 1914. The general refuses to believe at first because the accompanying forms from the field hospital say he's only an unknown crewman. Hence, the comrade captain answers, saying that everyone calls him Ivan Ivanovich. So, in the end, they have given his name Ivan Nadiwanov, which means found, since they discovered him from the tank. Afterward, they start talking about his body's miraculous peculiarity, which they have shown full of disbelief after he recovered from the burns. Unfortunately, Nadiwanov gets a rare case of retrograde amnesia, meaning he does not know who he is, but retains all his skills. So, despite having amnesia, the comrade captain suggests to the general that it would be correct to accept him as fit for non-combat duty since standing orders allow no exceptions. Later, Nadiwanov introduces himself to the two comrade captains as Sergeant Nadiwanov, a mechanic driver, and a second company. He then pinpoints the purpose of what he is doing in the tanks, telling them that a panther put it out of commission, and was ambushed. Confused, the comrade captain asks who said that to him, so Nadiwanov reveals that the tank told him itself. Unfortunately, it seems like Nadiwanov believes he can communicate with the tanks as if they are people, though he tries his best not to advertise it so that people won't think he's crazy. Still not believing, Nikolai asks again if the tank told Nadiwanov something. So, he says that it got hit by a white tiger, the same one that sets him on fire. Afterward, rumors arise about a new, invincible Nazi tank that appears seemingly out of nowhere. Nikolai's comrade tries to convince him that it is true because it wreaks destruction and disappears back into the forest. But then, Nikolai remains to disagree and suddenly walks out. Meanwhile, Wilhelm interrogates a captured German soldier about the white tiger painted completely white. As he tries to tell all the information about the white tiger, Wilhelm makes sure it's confirmed by asking if he sees it personally. Yet, the German soldier says that among the Russian tanks that attacked them, only the mysterious tank dubbed by the White Tiger of the Soviet and German forces could destroy all the tanks, and suddenly disappear as if it dissolved into thin air. Unfortunately, it is not the captured German soldier who sees it, but his comrade who took part in the battle that told him about it. After a while, the Soviets form a meeting to respond to the threat of the White Tiger. While conferring, one of the generals suggests that they should create one unique tank based on their T-34-85 with stronger armor, a more powerful engine, and only needing three crew members. Afterward, General Smirnov asks how long it will take, so he says that a month, yet the general seems eager to see the upgraded version of their tank, so he says it should be done in 2 weeks. Then, afterward, General Smirnov asks who's responsible for their plan, so Comrade Marshall says that it's Deputy Chief of Counterespionage of the Army Major Fedotov. After that, General Smirnov lets Major Fedotov choose the best crew. Without hesitation, he picks Nadiwanov as the commander and driver, Kriuk, the gunner, and Berdayev, the loader. Later, Major Fedotov talks with Nadiwanov. As they talk, he asks Nadiwanov how eager he is to fight against the White Tiger as revenge for his battalion who died because of that tank. Yet, Nadiwanov answers that the White Tiger is dead. Suddenly, Nadiwanov reveals that he sees White Tiger, and how it burned them mercilessly after it got itself to get killed, too. However, Major Fedotov shows a lack of interest in how the White Tiger died, only in the types of equipment inside it. So, Nadiwanov tells in detail what does the tank looks like. Since Nadiwanov is the most recommended soldier who knows how to maneuver the tank professionally, Major Fedotov requests that he be classified as a junior lieutenant with the commander of the experimental tank T-3485. Afterward, Major Fedotov proceeds to announce his new assignment to find and destroy the tank, White Tiger. Later, Nadiwanov begins his mission, and shares his plans with Major Fedotov. Nadiwanov then, says that the White Tiger hides behind the forest, yet the other crew begs to disagree, saying they have already checked the area, and there are no signs of White Tiger anymore. However, Major Fedotov chooses to believe Nadiwanov, and even asks him his suggestion. After that, Nadiwanov says he needs another tank to proceed to his plan, and ambush the White Tiger. Convinced, Major Fedotov lets Nadiwanov do his mission. After a while, Nadiwanov engines the tank, and hides it in a hole dug in the forest. While covering the T-34 tank, another tank appears in front of them with a soldier. And this tank's purpose is to lure the White Tiger into an ambush. Afterward, Nadiwanov orders him to go over the grove, and as soon as the White Tiger appears, he will distract it with gunfire and maneuvers. Later, Major Fedotov watches Nadiwanov and his crew prepare to capture the White Tiger. As Nadiwanov waits for the signal, the White Tiger finally appears, and destroys the other T-34 tank. As the White Tiger attacks, Major Fedotov, on the other hand, tries taking photos of it, but unfortunately fails. And while the White Tiger finishes destroying the other tank, Nadiwanov's tank suddenly appears, and gets hit by the White Tiger from behind at close range. However, it only inflicts minor damage before inexplicably retreating into the forest. Luckily, Nadiwanov's plan succeeds as the White Tiger decides to withdraw. After that, Nadiwanov's crew gets puzzled as they realize why the White Tiger retreats instead of destroying their tank. The fact that the White Tiger can easily ruin their tank makes Nadiwanov's crew think the reason why their enemy chooses to disappear instead of finishing them off. Afterward, Major Fedotov walks toward him to check his status, yet Nadiwanov remains silent. Major Fedotov then, says that the White Tiger outfoxed him. Meanwhile, the Soviets believe the White Tiger sank into the swamp behind the forest, saying that after the battle against Nadiwanov, the White Tiger disappears again. However, Nadiwanov refuses to believe the disappearance of the White Tiger, and says that it's still out there. While Major Fedotov, on the other hand, is almost convinced by his Sergeant Serpov that Nadiwanov believes in the tank gods. Later, Major Fedotov visits the camp where Nadiwanov is staying. Afterward, Major Fedotov suddenly sees him kneeling in the middle of the field while the wrecked tanks surround him. So, Major Fedotov walks towards him, and asks about the White Tiger. Nadiwanov then, says that the White Tiger is preparing, and waiting for their attack. Unfortunately, Major Fedotov tries to confirm if Nadiwanov believes in Tank God by asking him what the tank said. And it seems like Nadiwanov believes in the Tank God, and thinks it wants him to destroy the White Tiger. Nadiwanov then, reveals that he understands the tanks because he hears them, and the tanks are the reason he survives his battles. Full of disbelief, Major Fedotov still chooses to listen as he hears. Nadiwanov says that he thinks that when shells are fired at him, the tank will warn him of the incoming danger so that he can avoid it. In short, Nadiwanov tells them that despite the burn he felt after the battle, the tank still saved and protected him. Afterward, Sergeant Serpov convinces Major Fedotov that Nadiwanov needs to return to the hospital as he assumes that he's already crazy, and getting out of control. Yet, Major Fedotov refuses to follow his suggestion, especially when he hears Nadiwanov saying that he is convinced that the enemy tank is a crewless aerial vehicle, a ghost of the war, to be exact. And instead of reassigning the crew, Major Fedotov chooses to believe Nadiwanov, and assists him on his mission. Meanwhile, the Soviets interrogated the captured German soldier again. While they ask him piles of questions, the German soldier, later on, reveals that he does not know the White Tiger. He then, remarks that the legends of the tanks are everywhere, and cause them sooner fear than hope in the German army. Yet, the Soviets refuse to believe as they have not seen any document connected to the White Tiger. Later on, the Soviet tanks force takes the advance to attack the White Tiger. Afterward, they begin firing, and move their tanks towards the area of the White Tiger. However, the White Tiger fires faster and more accurately, causing them to be completely wiped out as they realize that its firing is way better than any human crew capable of doing it. To the Soviets' surprise, they witness how the White Tiger destroys their tanks in just a single shot. Afterward, the Comrade Army commander orders his soldier to withdraw as General Fedotov confirms that the White Tiger wipes them out. Meanwhile, the tank of Nadiwanov gives chase to the White Tiger. While chasing, Nadiwanov confirms to his crew that they are going to the White Tiger's area. Fortunately, they escape from the foggy area, and reach the spot of an abandoned village. Suddenly, Nadiwanov detects a Panzer IV tank concealed in a barn as they move. So, he orders Kriuk to hit it with an armor-piercing shell on the wall, level with the turret. Luckily, Kriuk hits it, disabling its turret. But, little does Nadiwanov know, the White Tiger is just hiding behind it, so Nadiwanov engages his tank to fight against the White Tiger. However, Nadiwanov's T-34's gun barrel suddenly gets some mud stuck in it upon maneuvering. To their surprise, the White Tiger suddenly shoots, but its gun misfires, giving them the access to move forward, and shoot his turret back to finish off the enemy. However, Kriuk's gun misfires as the cannon blow up. So, Nadiwanov gets out of his tank, and shoots the White Tiger using the gun, but then, it suddenly retreats and moves backward. Meanwhile, Fedotov goes to the office of the commanding general to convince him that both White Tiger, and the born-again Nadiwanov are not the creations of a man, but of the war itself. Fedotov even says that no man inside the tank operates it, only the tank itself. He also reveals what Nadiwanov says about the tanks that he hears, yet the commanding general seems unconvinced. The commanding general then says, if Nadiwanov hears the warning of his tank, why didn't he listen to it the first time? So, Fedotov answers, saying that Nadiwanov only possessed the capability after he got burned and survived. However, the commanding general is still not convinced, so he orders Fedotov to rest up, and have his 10-day leave. And when he returns, they will take the Berlin. Later, the peace talks between the Germans and Soviets began in a conference room after the Battle of Berlin in May 1945. Afterward, the Soviets start their discussion by asking the German representatives to familiarize themselves with the statement of complete and unconditional surrender. Luckily, the Germans agreed with their agreement and signed the contract. Then, after the agreement, the Germans' officers walked together with their soldiers while Fedotov and the rest of the Russian army watched them. Afterward, he begins to maneuver his vehicle to go to the field when suddenly he meets Nadiwanov fixing the traction of his tank. So, Nadiwanov gets out and talks with Fedotov. As they talk, Fedotov asks where his crew goes after the war, so Nadiwanov says they bury themselves drinking. Afterward, Fedotov convinces him to go home by saying that the war is already over. Yet, Nadiwanov refuses to agree, and says that the war is not finished yet, not until he finally destroys the White Tiger all by himself. Fedotov then, walks towards him, and says he's not there anymore ever since the Vistula battle. Yet, Nadiwanov still believes that the White Tiger is waiting, and just biding its time while healing from the wounds he gets from the war. Nadiwanov also says the White Tiger can wait for over 20 to 100 years before it strikes again. Leaving Fedotov no choice, he returns to his vehicle, and leaves Nadiwanov behind. However, right after he turns around, Nadiwanov suddenly vanishes into thin air along with his tank. The movie ends with Hitler sitting in a large room with a fireplace and mural paintings on the wall. As he talks, there shows that he's talking to a shadowy stranger while defending his actions during World War. Hitler then, says that after knowing each other too well for too long, the mere fact that his observations make him realize that he and Germany, will forever be seen as monsters from now on. Afterward, Hitler says that tomorrow would bring an unhappy Germany to his people as they would blame their country for the mortal sins it caused. He then, implies that the destruction of the Jews, and his attack on Russia was only a realization of what Europe dreamed of doing. And soon, the people would see from thousands of ridiculous documents about the immoral actions they brought during the war. Eventually, Hitler reveals that as long as the Earth revolves around the sun, there will always be struggles, including the clash between people and nations, resulting in a war that has no beginning or end, and war is the original human state. Thank you for watching. Subscribe for more videos like this to help the channel out. Have a nice day.